I'm Art Wiggins. Welcome to The Art of Physics. You know, in this series of programs, there's been one colleague of ours that has really dominated. And that colleague is somebody that we're going to have a lot to talk about today. That colleague is nobody other than Albert Einstein. Albert Einstein, we've done a lot of good things with him. I mean, he's a wonderful fellow in so many ways. And I needed help this time, because to really put him into perspective, I've enlisted the aid of somebody that taught me perhaps everything I know. This is Al Varone.
How do you do?
Hey, Al, it's awful nice to have you. I figured that we needed another Al to deal with Al Einstein. We used to have a poker game in which there were three Al's and an Art. And he was one of the Al's, we had two other Al's, and then I was the Art. And sometimes we just needed to have that kind of a critical mass in order to make things work. Because we're here to talk about, today particularly, we're here to talk about Albert Einstein and his greatest blunder. Poor Einstein had a blunder. You know, we talked about him earlier and his 1905 year, the Annus Mirabilis, the miracle year, in which he did so many things so beautifully. Oh my goodness. And they've seen that on an earlier program. So they know about the Annus Mirabilis, the viewers do. And however, there was a little bit of a problem, because one of the things that he did, Albert Einstein, was his Annus Mirabilis included special relativity. And what he said he wanted to do was to remove the restrictions on special relativity to make it general relativity. Now, the restrictions involved assuming that the coordinate system is one which moves with a constant velocity. He's made it special. He wanted to remove that, but he ran into a little bit of a problem. And the little bit of a problem was when he allowed accelerated coordinate systems, all of a sudden, the mathematics took a turn that he was unable to really deal with. And so what happened, he needed help, just like I need help, and that's why Al is here. He needed help, and for help, he turned to his buddy, Marcel Grossman. Now, do we have a picture of Marcel Grossman? There is a picture which shows you Marcel Grossman. He's on the left, and he's sitting next to his friend, Albert Einstein, and they have two other people there, Gustav Geisler and Eugen Grossman, who is Marcel's brother. These guys all went to school together, and they were absolutely terrific together. They had such a good time. Albert Einstein had trouble with the math, so he enlisted the aid of Marcel Grossman, and Marcel Grossman helped him with the math to the point where he was able to formulate his theory of general relativity. So his general theory is published in 1916. So Albert Einstein thinks, all right, I've really done this. You know, things are in great shape. But not so fast. Who's your friend, the Dutch cosmologist? What's that guy's name?
Willem de Sitter.
Willem de Sitter. Willem de Sitter. And there's a picture of him. And you can see him. He's talking to Albert Einstein. And he's telling him, in the very nicest way that you can imagine, he's saying, you know, your equations of general relativity are very nice, but the only way they can be solved is by having the universe be either expanding or contracting. And we know that it isn't expanding or contracting. In 1916, they knew that, sort of, they knew that. And so Einstein and Willem de Sitter talked about things a good bit, and Einstein finally said, you know what, you're right. And so Einstein had to retract his original equations and admit that there was something missing. So he added something called the cosmological constant. And this cosmological constant then was one which allowed the universe to remain static. He thought that this was a blunder. So just in order to show this graphically, I'd like to just remove Einstein. Oh, geez, we have three Einsteins here. I'd like to take him down a peg. And of course, he doesn't fit there, and he doesn't fit there, so we'll put him over here, and we'll even keep his little buddies with him, just in case. But you see, he had to be taken down a peg, because the result of that was that he made a blunder. So does that make him human? Well, I suppose in a sense it does, but funny things happened in the rest of the world at about the same time. I mentioned it was 1916 and 1918 that these things were going on, general theory of relativity. What else happened in 1916 and 1918?
Well, 1913.
Make it even worse.
Vesto, Melvin, Slipher.
Oh, those guys. No, I'm thinking about big stuff. Give me the big stuff that happened in 1916.
Oh, World War?
Yeah, World War. Because the World War just, it really changed everything. I mean, it distorted the field of physics, something vicious, because physics was out to try to do something really good with general relativity and special relativity. But what happened to the physicists? Were they able to carry on their work that well? No, there were a bunch of them that had to serve in the war. And so they were busy doing this and that and the other thing. And so they didn't carry out their physics the way that they would have liked. However, finally, the war ended and the experimenters got back to work. And one of the experimenters is a very interesting guy. I think we have a picture of him too. Do you recognize that guy, Al?
Hubble.
Yeah, that's him. Hubble. There he is. This is 1929. Hubble is looking through his telescope.
And Hubble.
What does he find, Edwin Hubble, as he looks through his telescope? Well, he surveys many of the things they called at the time nebulae. We now call them galaxies. And what he found was some things which he plotted on a graph. Let's see if we have the graph that we can look at. This graph shows the velocity of these nebulae along the vertical axis and along the horizontal axis. There's the distance. Now, he's got this for a whole bunch of them. And it looks like a whole scatter bunch of points. Can you see those points? Look, they don't look that straight a line, do they? Hubble says, you could put a straight line right through there and did. And when he did, he said, interesting thing happens here because it seems that the galaxies that are further away are moving faster and the galaxies that are closer aren't moving as fast. And the more you think about that, it brings up an interesting picture because, you know, if you're running a race, and let's say you're someplace in the middle of the pack running the race. If you look ahead of you, then the people that are really far away, the reason they're far away is because they're running faster. And the other ones, you look back behind and you say, the reason that they're falling behind is that they're running slower. And so...
Good analogy.
Nice analogy, because what it says is, the universe is expanding. And if the universe is expanding, then maybe it isn't static after all. And if it isn't static, well, then interesting things may happen. So, you know, Einstein is often quoted as saying that was the greatest blunder of my life when he made those, when he made the cosmological constant correction. I don't know if he actually said those words, but he clearly thought it was a blunder. But when Hubble published his information and from that became the Big Bang theory of the universe, then the net result of all that was Einstein was able to remove the cosmological constant. So then that made him feel very good. He actually went and visited Hubble. I think we have a picture of that one too. Let's see if that shows up. And here is Einstein. You see him. He's the one with the hair. Yeah, that guy. Right in the middle of the picture. And Hubble is the tall guy over toward the left, not the farthest left. Farthest left is Milt Humason. But there's Hubble and Einstein. And Einstein is visiting Caltech in 1931. And Einstein is very happy because he's able to take out the cosmological constant. Not only did he visit Caltech, he also got a chance to look through the telescope. In fact, Einstein was shown the telescope by Edwin Hubble. And he's climbing all over the thing. He's looking at it and says, what do you get when you look through here, Edwin? And he looks here, looks there, everywhere. And Hubble's a little bit afraid that the guy's going to fall off the telescope at that point. Einstein's wife, by the way, Elsa, she is there with him visiting. And she's waiting down below. And the people are talking to her. And they say, you know, Mrs. Einstein, with this telescope, we're able to probe all of the secrets of the universe and find out all manner of things. And she said, oh, that's very nice. She said, my husband does that on the backs of envelopes. So I'm not sure how impressed she might have been with all that. Nevertheless, astronomy isn't done, because this universe story continues. Some things happened beyond that, and the things that happened included when they started measuring the velocities of stars within galaxies, they found they were going too fast. How can they be going so fast? Something's got to be holding them in place. So what is it that's holding them in place as they're going so fast? And the answer was, we don't know what it is. We're going to call it dark matter. We're giving a name to our ignorance, dark matter.
That dark matter is wimps and machos.
It might be, but it's still ignorance for us.
It is.
And as if that isn't enough, the next thing that happened was they started measuring supernovas. And the measurements of supernovas revealed to them a very interesting thing, and that is that the universe isn't just expanding, it's expanding faster and faster. That is, the universe is accelerating. What in the world is causing the universe to accelerate?
A paradigm shift from accelerating inward to accelerating outward.
Right, and the acceleration is like, we have no idea what's doing this. However, we gave that a name too. The name for that is?
Dark energy.
Dark energy is causing the universe to expand faster and faster, accelerating. Do we know what it is? No, we don't know what it is. There's Nobel Prizes out there for people that figure it out, though, aren't
there? I made a limerick for that.
Did you?
I did. I wrote a limerick.
What? Do you have it?
I do.
Tell me.
The universe is infinitely expanding. On our finite minds, that's too demanding. Expanding into what, you scientific snot? Your theory definitely needs remanding.
Oh, that's right on the money. My gosh, we are scientific snots, aren't
we? What is it expanding into?
Yeah.
That's the mystery.
There's a great question, isn't it? But nobody knows. Here's the one thing we did find, and that was, thanks to another experiment, we were able to find out such things as the overall universe. What percentage of it is dark matter, dark energy, regular matter, etc.? There's a pie chart. Did you see that pie chart, Chief?
Amazing.
That pie chart says it's 73% dark energy, 24% dark matter. Everything else is in that final little 4%. That final, and most of that isn't us. That is, we are a tiny, I say us, what do I mean by us? I mean everything you can see. I mean all the stars,
and
I mean
all
the galaxies, all that stuff. That's us, and we are a tiny little fraction. I mean, do you want to talk about minorities here? We are such a minority in the universe that it's ridiculous to even discuss anything, because we don't know what dark energy and dark matter are.
Most of the mass of matter is in interstellar space.
Right, in interstellar space.
Hydrogen.
Yeah, a lot of hydrogen, some helium. And that's mostly it. How much hydrogen and helium are we? Nothing.
Very little.
Yeah, just about nothing. So that's kind of funny, isn't it? But nevertheless, so really cosmology, because we can talk about cosmology as being the overall study of the universe, cosmology is in deep trouble. Trouble in the sense that we don't know what dark matter is. We don't know what dark energy is. We really don't know. And that's the vast majority of the universe. Of course, I say we don't know. What I mean is we have no experimental evidence about anything yet. Do we have theories? Oh boy, do we have theories. We have theories coming out our ears. There's theories about machos and wimps. There's theories about why there's one theory that says maybe what we need to do is put the cosmological constant back in. Now, of course, if we put the cosmological constant back in, what does that do to Albert Einstein's greatest blunder? Well, I'm afraid if that's the case, then we're going to have to restore Albert Einstein to his position of greatness, because now his blunder may not be such a blunder after all. We just don't know yet. Oh my gosh. We don't know. Is that bad to not know?
I want to mention or say one of the wonders of humanity is Einstein could not accept an expanding or contracting universe. He just simply couldn't. It was static, eternal, infinite to him. And so he threw his cosmological constant in when De Sitter said it was expanding or contracting. He didn't know.
No, he didn't know. Nor do any of us know. That's why we need a new Albert Einstein. We need somebody to figure this out. And so far, we haven't been getting it. In fact, along that line, I want to apologize, make my apology to Albert Einstein, because I've kind of made fun of him during this program. Now, I'm putting him back on his pedestal because I think he belongs there. And this was expressed best that I ever heard, this my apology, best expressed in a song. David, can you play that song? The Beatles. That's the Beatles. Yeah. They expressed it very well. Uncle Albert, we're so sorry. We haven't done a bloody thing all day. We don't know what dark energy and dark matter are, but we're going to keep working at it. We're going to try and find out. So, but in the meantime, I want to talk to Al Varone, because Al Varone and I go way back. We go way back to 1969. That's 45 years ago.
When I hired you.
45 years ago. I met you at OCC and tried to convince you that, boy, would I like to come and teach physics there. And you said?
First explain to me rolling friction.
Oh, man, did we have fun. We had such a good time doing that.
And we started a course called Foundations of Natural and Life Science.
Sure did.
And you weren't with it. And I said, if you and Charlie Wynn weren't with it, I would do it alone. So you know it was impossible for me. So you joined. And in fact, you and Wynn wrote a book on the Foundations of Natural Life Science. And the second chapter of your book was entitled, you remember? The Scientist as a Detective. And the story of the science as a detective with respect to cosmology begins with Festo Melvin Slipher.
Right.
Observed the movement of about a dozen galaxies. And he found them all receding. They were redshifted. And he had no idea. In fact, he didn't know they were galaxies.
No.
He knew they were nebula.
They were
nebula. These nebula were redshifted. Nebula means that they were undistinguishable.
It's nebulous.
It's nebulous.
Same root word.
And so he investigated these nebula. And the story unfolds, and the nebula investigations then go to Milton Humason at Caltech.
Right.
With the 100-inch Mount Wilson telescope.
Yep.
That Edward Hubble designed and was part of the construction team. And Vesto Melvin and Milton Humason did the redshifts on about 50 galaxies and had no idea of what was happening. Had to turn to the theorist and practitioner, Edwin Hubble, and they finally produced the graph that Art showed, velocity versus distance. Velocity, done by the redshift on the x-axis, is relatively easy to get using spectrographic analysis. But the distance that Hubble got, distance was one of the most difficult things at the time, And first, Art, when was the first star, somewhere in the 1850s, found to be 25 trillion miles away? Who was the German physicist who discovered that parallax of 1 second?
Was that Bessel?
Bessel, that's him.
Yeah.
That was Bessel. Hubble was able to, Humason was able to get the red shift, but Hubble was able to get the distance. And that was and is and will be one of the most difficult things in physics, get the distance of these galaxies. Stars are close by, they're relatively easy now, but how far away are these galaxies receding at the speed of light almost now, up to 90% of the speed
right,
of light.
Right.
And accelerating.
It's amazing.
So I want to say about your book, the second chapter was Scientist as a Detective. And scientists are detectives, looking into how the genesis of the universe began. And it was a steady state theorist who called this expanding universe the Big Bang.
Right, right.
You remember who that was?
That had to be, what was it? He was saying it, thinking it was a joke. He was making a joke.
Making a joke. Fred Hoyle.
It was Hoyle.
Hoyle and Bondi and Carlyle came up with a steady state theory right after the war.
Right.
And it's a good theory. there are, we talked last week, and on Saturday I got a letter from a former student, very, very bright student. This student gave me this expression on a piece of paper. He wrote, "The universe is because there's no place for it not to be." How is it? It's the way it is. How could it be any other way? And I want to mention that there was a definition of a myth by a student on an exam, and the definition was, a myth is a true story about an actual event that never occurred. So I wrote a mathematical myth. I wish I could read what I had written, but it goes like this. A mathematical myth is the generation and development of equations and manipulation of geometric shapes, like in topology, that try to explain the origin and evolution of the universe. The origin of the universe was the domain of God. And the physicists became cosmogonists. Cosmogony has to do with the origin. Cosmology has to do with the evolution.
Right, the evolution.
And the evolution of the universe is pretty well studied and accepted. But on Saturday, I received a paper from a student I had, Charles Lambert. And the paper was that the Big Bang never occurred. There is no Big Bang theory, and there were prominent physicists in that. I have to mention this, I don't know why, just for the sake of trying to be truthful. There is a group that do not believe in the Big Bang.
Wow.
Imagine that. And that is like something like global warming. There is a group that do not believe that there's global warming. What's the word for global warming generated, that man generates this global warming, contributes to the global warming? There's a word for
it. Yeah, there is a word.
Yeah, forget it.
It's human origin.
Yeah, it's human origin. Yeah. Well, global warming is certainly a natural cycle. It's gone through it. There's no doubt about global warming, but there is doubt on how this global warming is produced.
Right, and the beauty of all this, of course, is that the way physics always sorts this out is we have our theories and we have people that believe and people that don't believe, but what has to happen is, let's see the evidence.
Yeah.
Show me the evidence.
Yes. Yeah.
Or as they used to say in, what was that movie, show me the money, because show me the evidence is what we need to really make this work. And so far, we don't quite have the evidence, but we're still waiting, and I say waiting, there are an awful lot of people working at this and working at it very hard. So Al and I go on and on. We play bridge together. We talk about Shakespeare together. We talk about the role of humans in the universe together. We've been doing it now for 45 years. And I don't think we're going to stop right away. We're liable to do it some more.
Yeah.
So I think we're running ourselves out of time here.
I can't believe we just started.
I know we just started. That's 45 years ago we just started. I can't believe that, too.
I got too much to say here. We'll have to do this again.
This won't be anymore. There's a picture of us when we started this in 1970.
Yeah.
And you can see, but is there any difference? A little older and deeper in debt. Do we have another one? I think there's one with Charlie, too. Yeah, that's our third partner who often does some writing with me. We've written several books together, Charlie.
Quite a few books.
That's
Charlie,
a bunch of us now from the 1970s.
I was never part of writing.
No, but you inspired us, and so that was actually a great part. So
yeah,
it was a great way to go.
It was a good team. We team taught.
Boy, did we ever!
That's an extraordinary thing that we team taught. I can't believe we did that. But
we had
we
such
did.
A great time.
Yeah. Jeez, we did. We used to play around with students' names.
Yeah. Well, this is the last program for 2014. I want to thank all my guests, especially Al Varone, for being such good sports. And I want to thank Bloomfield Community TV, especially David Sommerfeld, for turning a huge amount of work, because that's what this is, into an enjoyable experience. And I want to thank all you viewers for putting up with all of our shenanigans, because boy, we got plenty of them. There's plenty more physics to explore, like rainbows, extraterrestrial intelligence, red sunsets, blue sky, black holes, but I need your feedback. Please contact me through the website www.theartofphysics.com with your comments, suggestions, or opinions. You might even consider joining me on this side of the camera. So until next time, whenever that may be, I'm Art Wiggins.